Good morning and welcome to the Berean Bible Students Church on our last Sunday of 2012. There are some new faces here, and there's some that have been here for a little bit visiting family. It's great to see you all. We are glad you are here. I can't believe how quickly 2012 has flown by. As chairman of the church this past year, it has been a blast. It's been great. And really, I do want to take a moment to thank all of you. You know, we send our messages out online. Sometimes they're videotaped and sent out. And one of the things I don't think people recognize about our church, and if you're are visiting, we are a lay ministry. No one here is getting paid to do what we do. All right? None of us are professionals at this. God has given us this opportunity to serve, and so many in this church choose to serve in so many ways, and I thank you for that. I can't thank you enough for that. All right, so as we start this theme of climbing higher, I really don't want anyone to be sitting there going, oh my gosh, you know, Dave and the elders, they're telling us we're horrible. We're not doing what we need to do. Climbing higher doesn't mean you're low. Okay, it doesn't mean that. It means you could be high. You just have to climb higher. And I believe that in our lives, we are called to climb higher than where we currently are. And that's the challenge of what's coming up in 2013 for all of us. So as I think about our church, even as I think about myself, it becomes very easy to accept just this is who I am. This is who we are. This is what we do. And sometimes that has to be challenged a little bit. Force you to think about that in a little bit different way for yourself and then collectively for us as a church. So as we think about this year and this concept of climbing higher in 2013, it is about you. It is definitely about you. When you look into a mirror, it is about you. No doubt about it. You have to be aware of that. But it's also about us. It's about us as a group. It's about us as a congregation. Okay, it's about us realizing we're not alone in this. And then it's more importantly and most importantly about God. That's what it's all about. And we always have to keep that in focus. Because one of the things I've learned in my years as an elder in this church, you know, you guys aren't all the same. You're all different. You react to things differently. All right, I think, you know, I can deliver something a certain way and everyone should be on board. Let's go, all right? Let's be fired up about this. But it doesn't work that way. There's times I say things that 35% of the congregation thinks is outstanding, okay? Maybe another 20% is fine with it. And then there's always some who think, oh my gosh, that was horrible. Why would you do that? Okay, that happens all the time. We're all different. We respond to stimuli in different ways. We get motivated in different ways. Okay, there are some people, if you tell them they can't do something, guess what they'll do? They'll do it. It works. You know what? I really don't think you can do that. And they'll do it. Yeah, I will. I'll show him. Okay, there's other people, if you tell them they can't do it, they go, yeah, you're right, I can't. I'm not capable. So we limit ourselves, right? And so we all react and respond to things differently. And so as we go through this year, one of the things you're going to see is a whole bunch of different ways of approaching this. Be open. Be open to it. So what's a leader's role? As we think about the upcoming year, what should David Elliott's role be for all of you? How about Andy Weeks's or Mike Knapp's? Or maybe any of the other elders. Well, what's our role as leaders? There's a picture that some people have of a leader. You know, he's on top or she's on top of a platform and everyone else is just gathered around and listening, which is kind of like it is right now. Okay? All right, and that's the leadership. And we'll just listen to this person talk and whatever he says, boom, we'll do it. Okay? Other people have other views of leadership. Okay? Up in the upper right-hand corner, maybe it's the Pied Piper leadership style. Okay, one guy leads and everyone else just follows, straight behind. Okay, ooh, I'm mesmerized by him. I'm going to keep following him wherever he goes. All right, well, we don't have that here. Okay, I don't think any of us are that way, that anyone wants to follow us wherever we go. Okay, sometimes there's people who think we're climbing up, at the same time they're climbing down. Okay, sometimes people aren't sure where the path is going. So where does leadership fall into all of this? All right, well, the thing about leadership that I've learned over the years is leadership is not about the leader. It's about the need for followers. Followers are wanted. We as a culture, at least in our high school, we have all these leadership things for kids. Okay, leadership weekends, leadership weekdays. We leadership. Well, that's great, but if no one wants to follow, we're in trouble. All right, there's an importance of following, all right? There's an importance to following people. Have you ever been to a live performance, a live show? All right, and it's just, it's been, let's say, just an outstanding performance, right? They've acted, they've sang, it's been great. And as soon as that show ends, right, and they walk out, the whole audience just stands up and applauds, right? I mean, everyone's into it, okay? Hopefully you've been a part of that at some point in time in your life. I don't want to talk about that, okay? I want to talk about that performance you go to that's okay. It's good. You appreciate the people and what they've done, all right? And all of a sudden the show ends, and like one little group of people stands up, and they applaud, right? Then what happens? These people are leading, right? They're setting the tone. I mean, it's a simple act, right? You stand up and you clap. Not that hard, right? But everyone else is just sitting there. Then all of a sudden, a few other people decide, hey, you know what? I'm going to stand up. And then they stand up, and all of a sudden, now maybe you have eight people standing up. And people are like, huh? So all of a sudden, you get another group of people that stand up. Now all of a sudden, you reach a tipping point. You get to a point where if you're sitting down still, you're the odd one out. And so now all of a sudden, what happens? Everybody stands up and they start clapping. Everyone's a part of things. And it gets to the point where you don't know who was the first one to stand up anymore, right? It doesn't matter who was the first one. It doesn't matter who the leader was. What matters is the collective effort of everybody in that room, okay, in that auditorium. And so as we talk this year, and this a little bit about worship, it isn't about the leader. It's about the first followers. It's about those first people who jump on board and say, hey, you know what, we are going to go with this. We are going to make this happen. One of my hopes is that we have first followers that are sitting here. Because I know we have people sitting here who go, or might be listening to her like, I'm not doing this. Okay, I'm not that excited about this. Okay, why in the world would you have a theme? Our focus is Christ. Absolutely our focus is Christ. No doubt about it. But this can bring us all together. So we need first followers. We need people who will go forward with these things, who will try them, who will do them, who will help make other people feel more comfortable. And you might be like the first six or eight people who are clapping. Then all of a sudden things will spread and people will become more comfortable. And people say, hey, you know what? This is a good thing. All right, this is something that I'm seeing growth in other people. And then more and more people will buy in. Now, as a leader in church, it's not as hard for me, but in work it is a lot of times hard for me. It's easy for me to forget that it's not all about me. Here, I don't have as much trouble with that, okay? But at work, I do sometimes. Whatever it is that is accomplished this year, it's not going to be because of me. It's not going to be because of the elders in this church. It's because of all of us. Each of us pushing, pulling, encouraging, and fighting to climb. That is what will happen. Do you know that Mount Everest, is like a really high mountain? Did you know that? I mean, it's high. It's really high. There's people who climb that thing. All right, I guarantee you that if I decided tomorrow to climb Mount Everest, I would have a 0% chance of doing it. I'm not prepared. I can't climb that mountain. All right, there's no way in the world I could climb it. But you know what? I thought about it. I'm like, you know what? If I'm going to climb Mount Everest, I at least need to know how to climb it, right? So I'm figuring, right, a mountain that high, there's got to be like one path, one way to climb that mountain. It's just straight up, right? I mean, you got to follow this path, and that's it. And as I looked into it, it's kind of funny. There's actually 18 routes to climbing Mount Everest. 18 different ways to get to the top of Mount Everest. I never would have thought that. I was surprised by that. And I got thinking about this a little bit. And I got thinking, like, you know what? There's 18 routes to climb Mount Everest. And as we talk about climbing higher this year, there isn't just one route for you or for us. There's a whole bunch of routes that we're going to use to climb higher. We're going to start off the year talking about prayer. I think that's a great foundational point for climbing. Okay? Mike's going to talk next week about just the tools for climbing. Okay, those are great starting points, but we are all going to attack this and climb in different ways, different directions. We have to be aware of that, and we're going to do all we can to help you. So one of the things that we are going to do the same this year. And so for those of you that have those bracelets, please pass them out now. Sarah and Mark are going to pass them out to the younger kids. So those of you that are younger, get one from Sarah and Mark. Adults, get them from the other people who are standing up. In climbing, climbers tend to be connected. All right, it's for safety. Mike will talk more about that again. As you can see, you're going to get a wristband. We have adult sizes and kid sizes, so if any of you adults have little tiny wrists and you want a youth one, we can get one to you. All right, but this is a common thread. This will be something common that can tie us together because we'll all be climbing different ways, but we can utilize this as a common thread, something that we can wear. With this, you'll see that it says climbing higher on it. You can also see the verse, Habakkuk 3:19. All right, we'll talk more about that in a moment. On the inside, you can't see it, but you can feel a little, you can feel something on the inside of it. And for those of you who have better eyes than me, you could probably read it. All right, but it says BBSC 2013. So it's the Berean Bible Students Church 2013. So it's on there. Again, my hope is to wear it all the time. My hope is that as people see it on me, they'll ask me questions. I can talk to them. It opens up a possibility for to share something with them. And I'm going to give them out to people. Okay, I'll give mine out to people unless it's stinky. All right, then I'll give them a new one. Okay, because I tend to stink things up, unfortunately. All right, so I'm going to give them a new one, and they can have that. All right, and then I can get a new one from me because I'll have them. Okay, if you need a new one, come see me. All right, if people aren't here, if you're watching it at home and you're like, hey, I need one of those, hey, contact the church. We'll send one to you, okay? We want the people to be on board with this thing. So let's think about Habakkuk 3:19. It says, the Lord God is my strength. He has made my feet like feet of a deer, and he makes me walk on high places. You know what? I got thinking about this a little bit. And I realized, let's look at all of Habakkuk. Not all of it, but at least let's not just take that verse out of context. Let's look at it in a bigger picture, okay? And so if we go back a little bit, it says, I heard and my body shook. My lips shook at the sound. My bones began to waste away and my legs shook. Yet I will be quiet and wait for the day of trouble to come upon the people who fight against us. Even if the fig tree does not grow figs and there is no fruit on the vines, even if the olives do not grow, and the fields give no food, even if there are no sheep within the fence and no cattle in the cattle building, yet I will have joy in the Lord. I will be glad in the Lord who saves me. The Lord God is my strength. He has made my feet like the feet of a deer, and he makes me walk on high places. I got thinking about this a little bit. Habakkuk. And I thought about a man by the name of Benjamin Franklin. All right, the thing about Ben Franklin, I heard a story once, and it was in regards to Habakkuk. Mr. Franklin was the ambassador to France. And he was in a group of people who recognized that, you know, Ben Franklin had an appreciation for the Bible. He wasn't a Christian. He had an appreciation for the Bible. And he had a whole bunch of skeptics in France that were telling him how stupid it is, how it makes no sense, how it's just a really dumb book, and how you can get nothing out of it. All right, so Mr. Franklin decided to pull out a piece of scripture that he thought, you know what, I'm going to read this to them and see what they think, but I'm not going to tell them it's scripture. And so he read to them these verses. Okay, he read to them Habakkuk 3:17 and 18. All right, and they were amazed, okay? They shouted with acclamations of extravagant admiration. I mean, they thought it was great. It was a beautiful piece of writing. And they said, where did you find that? I mean, that's outstanding. Where did you find it? And he got to reveal to them that it was out of the scripture. So that was out of Habakkuk. Now, the thing about Habakkuk is I think there are some in this room, okay, some who will be listening, who really don't know that that might even be a book in the Bible. Okay, and I realize there are some of you who would be like, oh my gosh, how could they not know that? But there are, okay, let alone trying to find it. Okay, I'm still a table of contents guy sometimes with some books, right? I have to go to the front of the book, look in the table of contents, see what page it's on, and go to it. Okay, I'm not as good at drawing my sword as some of you. All right, so Habakkuk, let's look at this a little bit. Let's look into the scripture, because I want us to examine this today. All right, I want us to examine Habakkuk a little bit so we have an idea of where this verse on this band comes from. What is it about? Make it your own. So we're going to spend a little bit of time doing that. Okay, what is so magnificent about this? So first off, there are two faith facts in Habakkuk that I want to get across to you. Two things, all right, just two. All right, I hope it's not too hard to remember. All right, but two things that you need to walk away from here and going, okay, when I look at this verse, besides climbing higher, these are the things I have to be aware of. The first one is that true faith often includes an element of fear. True faith often has an element of fear along with it. Okay, think about the verses that were before this. I've changed the translation because the one I gave just said shook, all right? But this one, again, gives more terms. Think about what it does to the human body. Think about what it did to Habakkuk, right? I heard and my heart pounded. My lips quivered at the sound. Decay crept into my bones and my legs trembled. All right, wait a second. We're talking about Habakkuk here, right? Habakkuk, he shouldn't be afraid. He shouldn't be afraid, right? We have this picture of people, they shouldn't be afraid. I mean, there's a fallacy going around, okay, and that it's kind of that true faith is never accompanied by fear. That the concepts of faith and fear are incompatible. Yet, as you look at this verse, I'm hoping that you see there's nothing further from the truth. Okay, this mighty prophet of God, okay, this tremendous man of faith, trembled like a leaf in the face of his threatening circumstances. He had fear. Think about some of God's greatest men and women of faith. Okay, what about Abraham? The great father of the faithful, right? He knew time and time again what it meant to be fearful when he faced the uncertainty of the future. What about King David? He admitted at times that his heart was failing him in spite of his faith. How about the prophet Jeremiah? He felt at times that he just could not face the obstacles that were before him. What about John the Baptist? While languishing in prison, he found himself struggling with fear at what was lying ahead. And even Paul. Even Paul. Okay, he wrote in 2 Corinthians 7:5, "For when we came to Macedonia, this body of ours had no rest, but we were harassed at every turn, conflicts on the outside, fears within." So imagine for a moment Paul being fearful. He had fear. Fear is part of faith. Fear is part of that. Okay, you can't just eliminate it. The man who told us that Christ is sufficient for us in all things and how God will always supply all our needs in Christ Jesus, Paul was fearful. Tremendous man of faith had fear. So one of the things I want you to realize is if you do, stop coming down on yourself or on other people simply because you are fearful or you maybe see them wrestling with their fears. Stop, if you do, always equating spirituality with those who have an absence of fears or struggles. For those who are not in touch with their fears, for those that are not in touch with their fears, are often the least spiritual. Be aware of that. Now, we're not going back to Habakkuk 2:4, but the primary message of the book is really back in chapter 2, verse 4. And it's that you are to live by faith in your life. You are to live by faith in your life. And that does not mean that you must hide your fears and struggles. Okay, when you live by faith, you can be honest with yourself and with God, and hopefully we'll learn to be honest with each other. You can let people know that you are like Habakkuk, and that you struggle at times with real fears in the midst of your faith. So I want to tell the story of Muhammad Ali. Okay, some of you that are significantly younger than me, you have no idea who he is. All right, but he was a former boxing champion. Very arrogant. He knew he was the best. All right, he was an amazing boxer. And, you know, this is back in the 60s when air traffic, air flight wasn't like common for everybody. All right, but he was on a plane, and the stewardess was, you know, making her announcement, you know, telling everyone the exits are here, here, and here. All right, that has never changed. All right, and that you need to buckle your seatbelt. Okay, please buckle your seatbelts. And then she noticed that Muhammad Ali intentionally unbuckled his seatbelt. He didn't want his seatbelt buckled. And so she went up to him and she said, "Sir, please fasten your seatbelt." And Ali, he replied in his typical style, saying, "Superman don't need no seatbelt." And the stewardess, without missing a beat, snapped back, saying, "Superman don't need the plane either. Now buckle that seatbelt." Now, we live in tough times. We do. All right? There's death around us, right? There's struggles around us, illnesses around us. Okay, we know people who are going through a lot. Okay, we have a society that things happen that we can't explain. Okay, shootings occur that we can't explain. Okay, we just can't explain them. But the thing is we don't have to pretend that we are like Superman. Okay, we don't have to pretend that and have no fears. Habakkuk shows us that true faith often includes an element of fear. Now, the second point is this one. The true faith knows how to rejoice in God in spite of difficult circumstances. Okay, if you look at verses 16 through 19, okay, it talks about that more. And so what had Habakkuk learned that strengthened his faith? So what I want you to realize is that Habakkuk's faith wasn't just strengthened because of who he was. It was strengthened because he had the ability to look back and to look ahead. He had the ability to look in both directions. So if you look at the earlier verses, you'll see that Habakkuk had great description, all right, of the mighty acts of God in the past. But he also received a picture of what God is going to do one day in the future when Christ returns. It's a picture of a great and glorious hope, a time when God when Christ will return, okay, in power and glory, delivering his people. All right, it's an amazing time that Habakkuk got a vision of. So you and I, we're meant to find great comfort in that. Because not only do we think in the past and see how God has worked in our lives, but we also have a future hope, something in the future that we can look to. Okay, you think about the metaphors used in the Bible to describe heaven, right? Streets of gold, pearly gates, right? Gates of pearl. All right, these are metaphors that are meant to symbolize luxury. Now, what heaven ultimately looks like, okay, what we do know, it will be a place where discomfort of this life will be banished, okay, and it'll usher in new and unimaginable pleasures. It'll be a great spot. Now, the thing about it is right now, okay, this picture, you can't see much, okay? You might be able to see a little bit of light just coming down through here that's a little bit whiter, okay? You maybe see that. All right, if you've ever been in a dark room and you have a little bit of light shining in, right? It just gives you a glimpse of things. And that's kind of what we get in our life right now, is a glimpse of things. The glimpse of what heaven will be like. All right, Larry talked a few weeks ago about we're in the kingdom now. We have those opportunities, and we should get more than a glimpse, but we have those opportunities right now. So we must learn to see our present pain and suffering in a slightly different way. The ultimate solution to the problems we have as society is that we need Jesus to return. That's ultimately the solution. Okay? We need to be sustained by our hope and by our faith. And that faith, although at times maybe mixed with fear, should not be timid faith, but a bold, confident faith in an all-powerful God. There's a great story of a weary traveler, which I'm not going to tell you because I don't have time. Have you ever, the thing about our future hope, and again, I know you guys aren't all sports fans, but have you ever like DVR'd a game, a sporting event? Okay, DVR'd is recording, videotaped. I didn't want to use that word because, you know, we have a videotape over there now that's sitting by Tracy. But you want to record a game. And so you record a game, you do everything you can not to hear the outcome of the game. But somehow someone blabbers it to you and you know that the Bears win. Now, when you go to watch that game, you know the Bears have won. And you watch the game, and the Bears drive it down to the 10-yard line and throw an interception in the end zone. You see them give up 28 points in the first half. All these things that you know, if you didn't know that the Bears had won, you would have said, oh, they're going to lose this game and give up hope. But because you know they won, what do? You watch that game because you have hope. You know what's coming. You know the Bears are going to win. That's how our life needs to be. Okay? We are destined to win. We are destined to win. So all of these setbacks that are happening, we have a bigger picture. We know victory is there for us. We need to be ready for that. We need to be ready for that. Okay? We need to be willing to go. Oops. Okay? We keep going. We're going to keep progressing here. Okay? We need to be bold and confident in our prayers. All right? We need to be bold and confident when we go to God. All right? We need to have that type of energy, that type of passion. Okay? And you can go to the next slide. I'm about ready to show you a video, and this video is the song is by Lifehouse. It's called Everything. Members of the Youth for Truth a couple of years ago shared this with me, and it's a very powerful video. This video has been viewed by over 19.8 million people. David Elliott's viewed it 20 times, and all 20 times I've viewed it, I cry. I have an emotional response to it. One of my stimuli is video. It's pictures. That moves me. This is powerful. The basic gist of this skit is the following. There's a woman who is with Jesus. They are connected. You'll see that. She falls away. And she'll fall really far away. Okay, she'll get to a point where she'll actually look like she's cutting herself. She doesn't really cut herself to the children in the room. Okay, it's a skit. Okay, she doesn't really cut herself even though you'll see red on her arms. Okay, she gets so bad that she thinks about taking her life. Okay? She will not. But just watch and listen and just see how God moves you in this. So Andy, if you could start it up, that'd be great. 17.8 million people have seen this. Somebody some of you have seen it already. There's two parts in that that get me very emotional. The first is how easily she fell away. And it was easy. And again, I hope if some of you never had that experience in your life, I'm happy for you. But I know there are people in here who have. The second part is after she gets back and Jesus is holding off everybody. He's a shield. He's protecting her. To me, those are the two points that just jump out at me. And so as we think about this year, as we think about climbing higher, I am confident that struggles will come. I want you to think about when those struggles come, and my guess is they will not get nearly as severe as where she got to. But when those struggles come, just picture how hard she had to fight and claw and struggle her way to get back to Christ. And Jesus was there helping, pulling her, but she had to fight and claw and scratch and do everything she could. And she got beat up. Her clothes got ripped. She got knocked down repeatedly, but yet she kept fighting to get back. She kept climbing and climbing to get to Christ. And that's where we need to be as we go through this year. The real world, in the real world, it would have been easier for her just to say, that's it. It's too easy. It's easy to stop. And she didn't stop. She kept fighting. So I really have no idea how this year is going to affect each of us. But I would imagine that just like Habakkuk, and as we think about our wristbands and the theme verse, that there'll be points where we'll need to face our fears through our faith, and that where we'll rejoice with God as we go through our struggles. All right, so let's pray. Father, just please be with us this year, Father. There are so many things that as a congregation, we are confident in. There are so many things as individuals we are confident in. And I just ask that you be there with us as individuals, as we look to grow and as we look to climb higher, but also as us as a body of believers, Father. We just thank you for that. And if there's anyone, Father, that just does not know your Son, I do. I just want you to open their minds up to that, to who Jesus is and what Jesus is all about, Father. You know, Father, we're going to be having a baptism in a couple of weeks, and you know, in that second Sunday in January, Father, and if there's people who wish to be baptized, just move in their hearts. Have them come and talk to an elder, and Father, we just so love you, and we're so grateful for you giving us your Son. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.